Greetings, sir and sirettes, and welcome back to From the Depths with me, Lathrix. And of course, welcome back to the Vulture, now with a third cannon. Now, the third cannon is an exact duplicate of the other two cannons. It's simply been copy and pasted after I did a little bit of internal work off camera. But I have also removed both of the missile systems, thus giving us a rather spacious room to mess around with. I'm not quite certain what's going to go in here. Could it just be more RTGs and more batteries, thus giving us far more power and the ability to move far quicker? Or is it going to be yet another cannon? Could it be a flak weapon? Could it be a laser system? There's a lot of stuff we can probably fit in here, but nothing too extravagant. Now, before we do continue, and in a second I will simply go off back towards the west until we find a portal, as I'm still in the easier zone, I would just like to talk about something. There is a really weird bug currently going on in From the Depths. At the moment, a couple of models have been broken. So right now, the 1 meter corners can sometimes look like 2 meter corners. Now, this is only in appearance. There's absolutely no stat difference. As you can see, I can even build in the space you would think it would be, but it does kind of look like Sonic the Hedgehog is now identifying as an attack helicopter. So let's ignore that. Let's pretend that all these weird points aren't simply there, and let's go to our next zone and hopefully consider what we're going to do with this space. Wait. Okay, I have just broke the game. We are currently in the harder difficulty mode, and by the looks of things, yeah, I am definitely in the regular third person mode. I think I may have just found a bug. Now, people were telling me that occasionally this happens, but I didn't know how to do it, and I decided not to really look it up. But apparently, when you're in build mode, and you're swap... Actually, I'm not sure what I did. I was going to say, I did swap my build controls from keyboard to mouse for a brief amount of time, because I was having trouble on the inside of that wing. But I don't think that was that, because I went back to the normal mode afterwards. Okay, back to build mode, then out. Then back it. Okay, so apparently we are permanently in the third person mode now. Can I actually get back to regular mode, please? Okay, yes I can. And now we are back to the usual. I need to figure out how to do this, because people were asking if it's possible. Mouse controls. Regular controls. Wow, what a simple bug. So for those who are wondering how to do this, because I know a lot of you were put off by adventure mode purely because of this, well, it's currently a bug, so please bear in mind this will be removed probably fairly soon. I am fairly certain they know it exists. All you need to do is go into build mode, make sure you start off with the keyboard controls. You then go into mouse-based controls by pressing F3, and then you press it again to go back into keyboard. After doing this, you are no longer bound to your character, so once you leave build mode again, there we are. We are now in the regular third-person mode with no limitations. Exploity, yes. Fun, also yes. Turn! Either way, ignoring bugs and silliness, we are currently in the harder difficulty plane of existence, and it's time to discuss a few more options. So I was messing around, and this is how I found that bug in the first place, I was messing around with dedicated Hellablade spinners for forwards movement. Now, I actually use these on my battleship, which has made that entire lump of metal go from, I believe, 6 meters per second all the way up to 15. So I decided to add two very, very small spinners to the front of the craft. And, well, the results were surprisingly good, and our normal max speed is only something like 45, but now it's going just over 50. So these two tiny little blades, which are on this side and of course mirrored on the other side, have gave us 5 meters per second for a tiny, tiny amount of engine power. But before we do anything else, and this I have needed to do for a while, I am going to have to reattach some of the turning thrusters to the front of the craft. The reason is, only having them on one side tends to make you arc out when you're trying to turn around, which isn't really the best, and thankfully the front section here is pretty much empty. So let's quickly reattach those so I can turn correctly, and then we can do some harvesting and see about options for the wings. Do I want that like that? Yeah, go on then. You can be like that, then you can be here, and you can be blue in a second, and then that should turn out alright. There we are. And then air jet engines. I could add the larger variant, which is much more power efficient, but I think doing this might be better. Do I like that being so far in? I mean, it's a bit better protected, but I'd much rather have the armor there, so we are protecting the front. Why did I just grab a metal block? There we are. You go there, even with the correct paint scheme now. Let's make sure the paint is correct on the inside. What are we, savages? There we are. Our stripes are all in the right place. So you should be left, you should be left, and all the others should be left, and then the opposite side should be right. Either I'm going crazy, or dedicated Hellablade spinners are remarkably more efficient than thrusters, even more so than I originally thought. If we stop and use absolutely nothing, we are currently sitting at 3,700 engine power left. If I use these dedicated Hellablade spinners I've just quickly put into the wings, we are using around about 2,000-ish engine power, and we're going as fast as the thrusters were taking us. Which is much cheaper, as we can see. Oh! Well, we have an enemy now, don't we? Am I still in third person mode? Uh-oh. Where's my craft? Well, I'm going to be right back when I figure out where I am, or perhaps just do the bug again, so I do want to see the target for once. There it is, quite far away, in fact. And there it goes. Well, not the hardest of initial enemies. The thing is, when it comes to difficulty, it doesn't take into account the size of the crafts, because technically speaking, the Flying Squirrel is a godly difficulty, a very, very hard opponent, whereas the Onyx Watch Eerie, the giant flying thruster craft, is only an expert, and therefore technically less difficult. So sometimes we're going to be fighting enemies which seem remarkably easy, and I have very few complaints. Now, what I was saying before we were so rudely interrupted is that if we use internal Hellblade spinners, it's around about 1,000 cheaper than using those thrusters, which are currently... Okay, it's currently a little bit faster, but that is taking into account the dedicated Hellblade spinners we have here and on the inside of the edge of the wing. Maybe I should just swap over to full-on Hellblade spinners. It's even easier to control our speed. And also, like I said before, this should mean if we go into the water like I'm trying to do now, turning off our main blade and then going in reverse, we should be able to move underwater, which is going to be really cool. Here comes the main test. Now you may be wondering, Lathrix, my dear boy, why did you build the back section here in red in addition to the corners of the Hellblade on here and all of this internal stuff? Well, I am someone who changes their mind very, very often, and because of this, I just want to make sure that everything I'm building right now, which could be a very bad idea, can be very easily removed. So everything new is bright red until I've decided we're going to be keeping it. Yeah, okay, so we can turn left and right, okay, not particularly agile though. And if we start up the Hellblades on the inside, we can move forwards. Now the last test, can we maintain depth? So right now, that's our altitude. So we need to be a little bit higher than that, and there we go. And back down now. Yes, we can maintain altitude, we can maintain velocity, and we can turn. For all intents and purposes, right now, we are a functional submarine with weapons that don't work fully underwater. And of course, our detection system's all currently offline because we are underwater. But ignoring that, we have made a helicopter-submarine hybrid. I don't even know what to do with this. Like, I don't think I'm ever going to use it, or I will use it very infrequently. But either way, that is really cool, and I want to automate it in the future and then add it to a campaign, because that is a really, really cool concept, I hope you agree. And then turn on all of our thrust, and forwards we go! What speed are we going right now, anyway? There we are. So this is with both the thrusters and the dedicated Hela blades on the inside. We are fairly quick, actually. That's awesome. A new enemy, how lovely. And by the looks of things, it's a White Flyer ship. I'm taking a lot of damage already, even though we are very, very far away from it. So, let's get nice and close, if my controls would work properly. Not quite sure if that was a bug just then, or it's part of the adventure mode trying to get the bug away, but either way, that was very hard to control. And just look at that. I am moving at full speed towards this target, but it's so far away. And even with the shields, which are very good against fast shots, it's just being shredded. Surprised that the AI is still operational, to be perfectly honest. How close are we now, since we couldn't see myself a second ago? There we are. Almost there. I am moving at full speed, using the sprint option. And there we are. Hello, enemy. How are you? Actually, what are you? Ooh, we did some massive damage already. So here's the only problem with fast-shelled advanced cannons. Shields just are so good against them. And even with this fire rate, it's just being so deflected. Come on, get a bit closer so we can harvest it once it's dead. And a second explosion. Hopefully by a third. I really think as well, advanced cannons, particularly ones with kinetic and AP rounds at a very long range, are the ultimate weapon in this mode. Other than maybe very long range particle cannons. Basically, anything which is long range and cheap and easy to repair is going to be really good here. And down it goes. Excellent! Two enemies in the harder mode now destroyed, and that should give us a nice amount of resource once the resource actually gets to us, which should be fairly soon. I must say, it is weird going into third-person mode and still having to control the craft. Much more used to the automatic systems. Get the resources in a second, and there we are. So what do we need to do next? Well, we still have all of this space on top in the wing and underneath these blades. Yes, they don't actually have blades, they're just the regular spinner, but even so. And we could use that for a number of things. So we need to figure that out. We can go and get some more resource, and we can perhaps start arming ourselves for underwater combat, which wouldn't be too difficult. All we would need to do, go into the AI detection equipment, we need a sonar, we need some of the other stuff, just basically stuff from here which works underwater, and then perhaps torpedoes. I'm not a massive fan of them, but it would serve us very well and be very cheap. We also have enough space in the back of the wings here to make a decent torpedo system. Okay, so this is what we need to do next. So, ignoring all the stuff I said before about adding torpedoes and such, right now, we just need to make this a better helicopter. We can focus on making it a hybrid later, when we have more resource and more time, even though, to be honest, we're not exactly under much pressure at the moment. So, our biggest weakness is the fact we can't see underwater, and to remedy this, this lovely component thankfully exists, which is a piece of detection equipment which will detect underwater vehicles. If the missile is floating in the water or underwater, it will report these detections back to the vehicle that found it. Well, sorry, that fired it. So we already have the regular sonar, which will work once we're underwater. I've also got them on the underside and the side of the vehicle. But, of course, that only works if we're underwater. These can be fired from the vessel. Uh-oh, problem. And then be used. We have an enemy over there, okay. So first of all, enemy, then we'll talk about this some more. Well, that is not a particularly strong enemy. That is a Riverholm. At least, I think it is. Yeah, I'm fairly certain it is. That is not a difficult opponent in the slightest. Mostly made out of wood with a little bit of metal, like the bit we just broke off. This is one of the deep water guard vessels. What are you doing here, little thing? Also, the lack of sound is really bizarre. Clearly, this bugged state is definitely bugged. well, goodbye. Thank you for the resource. We need to improve our weapons when we're a little bit longer range, it seems. Two damaged and defeated. Come on, I really do want to see a larger opponent. I want to see something that can kill us. I know it sounds weird, but come on, I am tempted to go through another red portal. We are already on harder, but this doesn't really feel too much harder yet. But saying that, perhaps we're just getting incredibly lucky. So yeah, back to this. It's a pretty simple concept. We attach these to missiles. We drop the missiles using control blocks when we detect an enemy which is a certain depth under the water. They hit the water and then report back where the enemy is. At least, that's the basic idea. So we should be okay with that, and it's a fairly simple concept. In fact, I would argue it's simpler than the flare system we've got, which also needs to be repaired still. Ugh, there's so much stuff we need to do. And thankfully, actually, I was just complaining about how hard the enemies are, but thankfully they are being nice right now, considering we are still building up a lot of stuff. Look, I've even added dedicated Hellblade spinners in here to increase our speed whilst underwater. Yay! After messing around with controls for a while, I've decided our new torpedoes, with their sonars and ballast tanks, are going to be manually controlled. Originally, I was planning to have it all automated as soon as there's an enemy below X altitude, fire the sonars, but I feel like being able to throw them out whenever I feel is necessary might be a little bit easier. Also, the fact is, the sonars can work with boats. Sometimes I'll want to use it against boats if we're damaged, sometimes I won't, and I feel like just manual control makes it a lot simpler for me. So for that, oh, that's it. Just simple, nice, and oh. So now if I press O, we drop our little sonars into the water, which will give us all the information we need about any submarines within, I believe it's a massive range, at least I certainly hope it is. The last thing I would like to do, though, is add a staggered fire, because I feel like that would just look better. And then, more importantly, I would like some ejectors. This way, we can at least throw them down fairly quickly. Ah, you can only connect it to the side, can't you? Well, that's a little bit annoying because that looks really busy now. So try two, and there they go. That's exactly what I wanted to see. So those quickly go into the water, or at least fairly quickly go into the water, and now I can detect things around me because the sonars are attached to my main mainframe. Everything is good in the world. Also, I have removed the flare system because we're going to be adding those to the outside in just a second. Upgrades take time. The flare system is almost online, but we are currently under attack as the mist very annoyingly starts to roll in yet again. So what is this? It looks fairly big, not huge. I'm assuming it's one of the Onyx Watch ships. In fact, I'm fairly certain it is now we're close to it. I mean, just look at this. It's definitely one of their ancient historic broadsiding ships, which is being absolutely torn apart by armor-piercing rounds because it's mostly made out of wood. So the shots are going through like 3 or 4 layers per hit. Well, the enemies have been pretty boring so far. I'm not going to lie, for the sake of entertainment, the enemies have been very boring. Please start sending things harder against me. I think if the next enemy is this level again, I'm going to go through another warp gate because it's getting so dull not being able to take damage from anything. There we are. That looks really weird. Now, here's the thing as well. Because we've changed how the rotor blades work, we can a lot easier start to capture ships if I'm a little bit smarter about it. Right now, I won't bother because it will definitely disintegrate before we get there. But in the future, we can turn off the mainframe, get close, and then manually descend, which will be nice and easy. An issue I've only just thought about is with the flares. At the moment, when they fire, they are going to fire even if we are underwater, which of course is going to be a pretty big issue because they're simply not going to work underwater and thus we're going to waste ammo. So I will have to work around that a little bit, which is honestly really, really annoying. That is of course going to be one of the issues with having a helicopter which is going to go underwater. Believe it or not, there's issues involved. Also, we are rocking so badly right now because I've decided to increase our altitude. Being this high, we can't get any higher than this. This is at maximum capacity, and it's like we're being held up by string. A few minutes later, and I have now added some ammunition to the top of the wing. It's all very heavily fortified with heavy armor, and of course, this is one of the more shielded areas of the helicopter, so it is pretty safe. And this has mostly alleviated our ammo problems. As you can see right now, two of my turrets are both currently reloading. They are belt-fed loaders, which means they reload in a burst outside of combat, or if they completely run out of ammo, and we are just about regenerating more ammo than two turrets take up, so we're pretty okay now for ammunition. The problem is, though, I still have the issue with the flares. They're not going to serve us well at all underwater. And what I may do, because it'll be easier to regulate, is change the flare system for a very small, very simple anti-missile laser system, which could be mounted on the underside where we still have a lot of space underneath the bottom blades. We also have an additional set of armor, so we can go down by two, and that should be big enough for a weak but somewhat effective anti-missile system, which at least can be turned off very easily once we go below a certain depth. I'm afraid, though, after looking at the clock, I'm all out of time for today's episode. So if you have enjoyed, then of course, likes, favourites, shares, comments, all that good stuff helps out me, helps out the channel, and most importantly, shows that From the Depths is a series you wish to see continued in the future. Now, I would like to say that in the next episode, we will be going through a red gate, and I do have a goal in mind. I need to get to around about 150,000 resource, and then I'm going to do a massive retrofit, another huge redesign, giving us more space on the sides, giving us more space on the inside, and just ultimately opening up a lot of different avenues. This entire episode, is mostly with the off-camera building, I have just been fighting the fact I have built this far too cramped. There is not enough space to do all the things I want to do with any ambition. Some of the more simple things I can do, but right now we need to change the shape of the craft, but I just don't have enough resource to do that. I want to add loads of more components rather than being stifled. So next time, kill enemies, harvest resource, then hopefully end going through a blue warp gate. So thank you again so much for watching. I hope you've enjoyed, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye.